Scholastic Audio presents Zane and the Hurricane, A Story of Katrina by Rodman Philbrick, read by Jerry Dixon. Chapter 1, My Stupid Trip to Smellyville. Bandy is a mutt like me. He's black and white and small enough to hide in a gym bag, except he can't keep from barking.
Hi, hi, hi!
With his silly tongue hanging out and his little tail sticking up, Bandy, short for Bandit, because of the black markings across his eyes and nose. Don't get me wrong, he's the best dog in the world, and what happened wasn't really his fault, even if it nearly got me killed 2 times. 3, if you count the tippy canoe. Later on, he made up for it by totally saving my life. Of course, none of it would have happened if my mom didn't make me visit the Golden Oldies in Smellyville, which is what I call New Orleans before I knew better. Before the wind and the rain and the flood and me having to pretend I was brave, even though inside I was scared to death. My name is Zane Dupree. I need to warn you right now, there's some really gross stuff in this book, and I'm not talking about make-believe gross like plastic poop and vomit, but stuff so awful it made a dog hide his nose. And believe me, Bandy will sniff at most anything. Other than dog food, his favorite smells are dirty socks and toilet bowls. So that should give you an idea how bad things got. Okay, deep breath. Back to the beginning. How it started. Me going to New Orleans. If you don't already know, summers are pretty great in New Hampshire, where I live. The sky is blue and clear, and the days last almost forever. This one perfect summer morning, Bandy and me are out in the front yard fooling around for a while, playing this game where he tries to guess where I'm going to throw his ball, which I do with my eyes closed, and most of the time he guesses right and is waiting there before the ball hits the ground. Mom says me and Bandy have some kind of boy-dog mind-meld thing, like we can read each other's thoughts. I don't know about that. But for sure, that little dog seems to know what I'm going to do before I do, which is maybe kind of weird, but also really cool. Anyhow, when we come back inside that perfect summer day, my mom is sitting in the kitchen with the phone on the table and her eyes all red. "Did somebody die?" I ask, because that's how she looks. No, nothing like that," she says, sniffing back a tear. "The opposite. Somebody I didn't think could possibly still be alive." Oh, yeah. I forgot to mention about my father dying before I was born. Mom and him met when they were in the Air Force, and then they got married and moved to New Hampshire and started a new family. Me. My dad happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. Some old Gumby had a stroke and ran him over. For the record, I really hate it when people feel sorry for me because my father is dead. It's too bad he died and everything, but I never knew him, so I never missed him, okay? Because you can't miss somebody you never knew, can you? Anyhow, back to my mom. She's all weepy because she finally managed to locate one of my father's long-lost relatives. Her name is Beatrice Jackson. They call her Miss Trissy. She's your great-grandmother, and from what she told me, she pretty much raised your father in New Orleans, Louisiana. New Orleans? You said he was from Mississippi. She nods. That's what he always told me, Biloxi, Mississippi. Didn't ever have much to say about his family or what happened in the years before we met. But Gerald was living in Biloxi when he enlisted in the Air Force. I always knew that for sure. It's right there on his induction form. So when the accident happened, I called every Dupree in the book down there. My own father, bless him. He even hired a local investigator. But it was a dead end. Never could find any of your dad's relatives in the state of Mississippi. We thought they were all gone. You already told me that stuff like a bunch of times, I say, dropping into a kitchen chair. Mom gives me this pleading look. Don't be angry at me, Zany. You'll be 13 on your next birthday, and I thought you should know something about your father. Whatever there is to know. Something besides photographs and me with my stories. So, I tried this new website for connecting families, and what do you know? It worked. Okay, fine, I say, making a bored face. So now I know. There's an old lady with a funny name that used to know my father. Raised him. She raised him, Mom says, excited and talking fast. She's your blood, honey. From what I can tell, she's all that's left. And she never even knew you existed until she picked up the phone this morning. She sounds really lovely and very old, of course. And more than anything in the world, she wants to see you before, you know.
Before she dies?
Don't say that.
It's what you mean, isn't it?
Zany, listen to me, she pleads. This is important, okay? We need to get this right.
Fine, whatever.
At first, I figure the old lady will visit us in New Hampshire, and I'll have to be nice and everything. But it turns out she's too old to travel, and since Mom can't get time off from work, she thinks I should go down there on my own. By myself, without Bandy.
Totally no way, I say, folding my arms. Never gonna happen. Never, never, never.
Never is a bad word to use on my mom. She also hates it when I say, totally no way. She's never hit me, not ever in my whole life, but that day, we have a big yelling fight that ends with her slamming her bedroom door. I can hear her sobbing, which totally ruins everything because it wrecks me when she cries. Maybe it isn't cool to say this, but she's the best mom in the world, and I'd never on purpose make her cry. Are we clear on that? Good. So eventually, we come to an agreement. If the old lady lets me bring Bandy, I'll agree to visit her for the last week of summer. To call that bad timing would be, as Mom later said, the understatement of the century, because I fly down to New Orleans on a Monday in late August. The very next day, something called a tropical depression forms near the Bahama Islands, almost 1,000 miles away. A day later, they give the storm a name. They call it Katrina, and it's coming to get us, but we don't know that then. We don't know much, me and Bandit the Wonder Dog. All we know is we don't want to be there. Chapter 2. What the Old Lady Said. The truth is, when me and Bandy first get off the plane and this old lady is waiting there with her two canes, one in each fist, I'm kind of scared of her. She's so wicked old and the canes look like weapons, like hitting sticks. This really ancient lady, small and hunched with her hitting sticks. Her skin like the skin on milky hot chocolate when you blow across the top, all wrinkled and folded back on itself. Even her perfume smells like old flowers or something. More than anything, I want to get back on the plane and go home. But then the old lady says something that changes my mind, at least a little bit. Standing there kind of wobbly on her canes, but smiling like the sun peeking through a cloud, she goes,
"Young man, seems I've been waiting all my life to meet you, though I didn't know you existed. Or what your name might be. The good Lord has given me a great gift. Thank you, Lord. Praise be, Zane Dupree. You are welcome in my home today and always will be. Mm-mm-mm."
You can't be afraid of a person who says that. You just can't. Plus, Bandy likes her. Right away, he rolls over and shows her his tummy. So that's another thing in her favor.
"Hello to you, too," she says, scratching behind his ears with the tip of her cane. "Let me guess. This dog part terrier, and the rest nobody quite sure is that about right?"
"Yes, ma'am," I say.
"Can you drag your bag and that little dog, too? Taxi cab waiting on us."
When we first walk out of that terminal into the heat of the city, it's like, whoa, are they kidding? This has to be a joke. I've never been anywhere that's so unbelievably hot and humid. Like the sky is sweating and everything smells kind of stinky and moldy and wet.
That's when I start to think of New Orleans as Smellyville.
I didn't know it then, but the wet and stinky part was about to get much, much worse.
Chapter 3. Older Than Dirt.
Okay. That's settled. how me and Bandit happened to be in New Orleans when the hurricane hit. The other thing you should probably know is, I'm what they sometimes call biracial or multiracial or whatever. White mother, black father, okay? Except if you go back to everybody who came before me, there's way more than two races. There's African and English and Saxon and Celts and Creole and Cherokee, and that's just for starters. I bet there's even some Chinese ancestors if you go back far enough. Turns out Trissy Jackson has strong opinions on the subject of race and color.
Multiracial? No, that don't say it. That don't get the true flavor. You of mixed race, boy,
she says, studying my face and humming to herself, which she does all the time.
Yep, you mixed, same as me. Let me explain. My daddy was a light-skinned Negro. Call him High Yeller in his day. That was an insult. But he did think very high of himself come to that. See, one of my daddy's grandfathers was white, and his own mama was a Creole of color, which is partly African blood and partly French blood, descended by way of the Free People of Color, a whole class of their own. So you all kinds mixed together. But it don't matter who was my daddy's people. My daddy was colored because African blood made you colored. Even if half your ancestors was white, Them was the rules. Them was the laws. Sounds complicated, I know. But in the day, we all knew what was what. Who was who?
Hardly nobody says colored now, I point out, in case she doesn't know, being so old.
I just did,
she says and laughs.
For your information, colored was a polite word back then. When I'm speaking of when I was a little girl, long, long time ago, you and me, we got a lot of catching up. All your life and some that came before. Oh, my, yes. From the look of you, your mama's got true blonde hair. That about right? I nod. And you got her straight hair mostly, except yours is darker hair. See, hair is what folks see first. Folks don't know no better, might glance at you and see only a white part on account of your hair. White boy with freckles and thick straight hair and them green eyes. Oh, but I see Gerald in you too, yes I do. Gerald's chin, Gerald's skin and nose, Gerald's freckles. You got his same mischievy look about you, and that's a fact. Oh, Lord have mercy, your daddy looking at me from out of your face. Yes, he do, no doubt, no doubt. The humming, the it isn't regular humming. It's more like church singing, hymns. Miss Trissy still sings in the church choir every Sunday, even if it takes two canes to get her there. She says she has the voice of a much younger woman, and I'm to go to church with her this coming Sunday so I can hear it for myself. Much younger, she insists proudly. My singing voice so young it still go out dancing on Saturday night. There, I made you smile.
When I say Miss Trissy is wicked old, I don't mean she's wicked like a bad person, because she's the opposite of that. I just mean really, really old. I ask how old exactly, which apparently is an impolite question, and she leans on her canes and gives out a little snort and goes,
Exactly is it. I tell you exactly, I'm exactly older than dirt, child, and that's all you need to know.
And then she softens up and explains how it's bad luck to brag about her age, because the good Lord might be listening and have cause to remember that she's long past her sell-by date.
Y'all got no idea what that means, do you, young Mr. Dupree? I can see by your face you don't. Sell-by date is what they stamp on a carton of milk. Sell by such and such a date, because after that it go bad.
So you've gone bad? I asked, trying to be funny.
Oh, you a terrible child,
she says, but her eyes are smiling.
Terrible, terrible. Most of me gone bad, and that's the truth.
Bandy's ears perk up whenever he hears her voice, especially when she laughs, and he likes it when she scratches his tummy with the tip of her cane.
"You understand what we speaking of?"
she says to him.
"Ears that big, you don't miss a thing. Oh, you a good one, you."
Miss Trissy has a story about everything in her little white house. How the rug in the hallway came from Algiers. Not the city in Africa, but a neighborhood in New Orleans.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.